Back in the tent, even after Todd Bentley has left the stage and the TV cameras have turned off, the experience of God continues for dedicated tent dwellers.
I can feel it.
People want real. They want real. They don't care if real is ugly. They don't care if real is raw. They don't care if real is, you know, something that is so out of the ordinary. They just want real. The way to explain his presence can only be done through the emotions that our bodies can actually, we can put terms on. It's overwhelming. It's peaceful. It fills me with joy.
Sometimes people don't understand the manifestations.
How does it feel?
Oh my gosh. God is so amazing.
I don't even know if I necessarily even understand it, because it's just an issue of keeping your eyes on Jesus. It's not saying, okay, well, I want to manifest, and I've heard people say that, you know, and I always tell them, man, just keep your eyes on Jesus. You know, it's about drawing close to God, and it's like, whatever happens, happens. I mean, I happen to manifest, and my body moves as he draws closer to me, but there could be somebody that's like drawing close to God, and he's just sitting there because it's totally about the heart.
I'm blasted.
For most tent dwellers, an experience of God will last for a few minutes, but for this girl, it's lasted a few days.
Shabam!
Well, she got hit by the Holy Spirit, and she's been unable to walk for about 3 days.
3 days.
3 days.
Yep. 3 days.
Thank you for grace and mercy, Jesus. The power of the lion.
Oh, that was so wonderful.
That's so cool.
It was so vivid.
I'm so red that he's on top of me. The big lion. It makes sense because I can't move.
Yeah. At first, she couldn't move and hardly talk. And she just filled with so much joy in the presence just being around her. It's crazy. It's hard to describe for someone who's not used to it. Luckily for her, roommate is always around, so it has helped her with the shower, and then I just take her to the bathroom, and the roommate helps her with the bathroom. This is so funny, but I mean, it's just normal life.
3 days
now. 3 days.
Man, oh, I got it. Whoa.
You enjoying this?
Yeah, I just go along for the ride. That's my daughter.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, okay.
It came right back at us.
This is 7 days now. It's intense. I mean, you can feel the presence all around, and a lot of these people just carry so much of it inside of them. The power's just unbelievable.
I got you. Yabba, yabba, yabba.
Are you staying at the campground too?
Yes.
Yep. And what's that like?
Oh, it's like a commune, you know? Just everybody's so happy and so free, and just everybody, they're all just juiced on God, and they're ready to spread the fire. All four corners of the world, we're going to spread this fire. Man.
My pastor told me that people were being healed from scars, and when I brought Sophia first down, she was clinically depressed, she was suicidal, post-traumatic stress syndrome, panic attacks, and she was cutting. I brought her down because I knew her scars really, really bothered her, and I thought that, you know, God was gonna heal her scars. She got down here the first night. She took Prozac and Klonopin. She refused to take them from the very first night. She cried for the first 4 days, and then after that, she
got
hit with
everybody.
The joy.
God bless.
And the anointing fell on her, and she's been like this ever since.
I called these kids the toddlers because they were the young followers of Todd. These kids were not just there at the revival to hang out. They were the hungriest of disciples of them all. And as a result, maybe they've gotten the most of God. Deeper into Lakeland, I found that the underbelly of revival was sort of crazy, but fun. These were not the faces in front of the cameras. They weren't the celebrities or the rock stars. They were the salt of the earth.
So what's your name?
My name's Ben.
Ben?
Yeah.
And where are you from, Ben?
I'm from Gainesville, Florida. I've come here since the third weekend and come back and off on and on. I wasn't like this before the revival, but I've experienced the presence of God. And it's changed my life, and I've been filled with so much joy and love. So, yeah.
Lord, I just pray. Oh, whoa, Lord, a fire to, Lord, just change the hearts of lost people. Lord, whoa!
Many of the toddlers live in this campground, just a few hundred meters from the tent. Toddlers are the hardcore fans of Todd Bentley's ministry. Todd is their hero.
All the people that are bashing Todd Bentley, if you think he's fake and you think all this ministry is fake, then quit bashing him and go out and start your own and get people to follow
no,
you.
No, 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 forget it. They can do that or they can just come check it out.
Yeah.
Instead of worrying about what you're seeing on television, because you're not seeing the whole thing, instead of worrying about what you're hearing from this guy and that guy, if I would have listened to all of them, I wouldn't even been here and I would have missed out on the blessings. So I say, you want some, come get some, come get some blessings. That's what I'm telling you.
I didn't believe in any of this, you know, flopping on the ground, throwing your hands up, and you're speaking in tongues. No way, it's all fake. They're just a bunch of little, you know, give them a padded cell and they'll be okay. I came here 17 days ago, and 12 days ago, my pancreatic cancer has caused me pain that was terminal, gave me 1 to 3 months to live. I'm now on my second month of that death sentence. I've got more energy now. The noticeable lumps in my side are gone. The pain is gone for 12 days now. So, and I didn't believe.
Well, how did you get prayer?
That's the funny thing. I went out, I was at the tent. I went outside to smoke a cigarette. When I came back in, the pain was gone. Anything's possible. I mean, if I can wake up and not throw up like half of my intestines, something's going on. The lump is gone, the pain is gone, the lethargy is gone. It's a miracle, especially for me because, you know, I've got this big smiling devil on the side of my neck, and God still has the compassion to say, you're one of my sons, you're one of my children, and I am gonna touch your heart, and he did.
What's up, honey?
Deeper into Lakeland, I'm finding that these are not what you'd call normal churchgoers. From a suicidal ex-Marine to a hip-hop Canadian preacher to a laughing intercessor, the movement of God seems to be affecting society's most disaffected. Many of them, like Peggy Pollock, have made a huge sacrifice to come to Lakeland and experience revival.
I was at the revival May the 2nd until May the 27th, went home and gave away everything I own, came back and moved here basically, and have been here ever since. It turned into a family. We had no idea that a campground would turn into a family. And there's mothers of the faith and fathers of the faith, and then there's kids, and they'll come up, and sometimes they just come up and say, I just need a hug, I miss my mama. So many young people here come without food, without provision. And because I had moved here, I had kitchen stuff. So I said, Lord, what do I do? He said, feed them. So we began cooking, and all we had money for were rice and beans because we're all living by faith, a lot of the ones that are here permanently. And so I think that's why I'm here, other than intercession and God changing me and going out to the nations and all the beautiful things that he's doing.
Peggy's story is just one of thousands of stories of revival goers from all over the world who have come to this tent for prayer. I wonder what is causing people to keep coming back for more in Lakeland.
That was intense.
That was amazing. You know what? He prayed for me, and like the impartation actually tasted yummy when I got up. It was like, wow, this is yummy.
As I sneak up on stage for prayer, I want to experience more of the phenomenon of Lakeland.
Get the camera guy.
Yeah.
This is the documentary of the dude on the floor.
It's the worship sometimes.
to think that the God of the universe, eternity, just came down into our natural temporal realm and just brushed away your, I mean, that changes people forever. I mean, people don't forget when they're healed. The greater message, you know, has always been, this is for you. Let's raise up an army and let's see every ordinary believer carrying this anointing to heal the sick.
Todd Bentley's army is comprised of the most unique members of society. They've been gathering from all over the world, first by the hundreds and now the thousands. But Todd wants to reach the millions with the message of healing. But are the millions ready for Todd's army? As I dig deeper into the culture of revival, I'm about to find out. The Florida Outpouring is now gaining steam, with its nightly broadcast being viewed by millions of Christians across the world. Along the way, the BBC, Geraldo Rivera, and ABC News have reported on the movement, causing an even greater stir across the church worldwide. In the last 90 days, Todd Bentley has been preaching and praying for the sick nearly every night, with services lasting for an average of 3 hours. I'm wondering if this is having any effect on Todd's energy levels.
Let the seizures stop in Jesus' name, God. No more seizures. Pray that. No more seizures. In Jesus' name, keep praying for Richard.
But even if he is tired, Todd is going to keep on preaching.
I'm getting ready to preach in Charlotte and Spokane and making plans to take this thing to the nations. And there's got to come a place where the people go, we are here for the presence of God. Crowds will follow me all over the world.
Todd Bentley has announced he's taking the revival on the road. He is confident that with a world tour, the power of God will reach every corner of the globe.
Hey, the world's been coming to us. Let's take this thing to the world. I like the excitement of in a city for 4 days and taking it to different cities. You know, as an evangelist, you need to be going in and out. You know, we want to take this thing on the road.
As an evangelist, Todd is used to moving from city to city and country to country. Some think it's a miracle he's been able to stay in one town for so long. But according to Roy Fields, Todd's worship leader, it's in the heart of a revivalist to be on the move.
Okay, the definition of a revivalist, you could drop a revivalist in the Sahara Desert with no money, and you give him about 2 weeks and he'll have a revival. That's a revivalist. It's like, it doesn't matter what you throw at me, I'm going after God. That's how I lead worship. You don't think there's been nights where I get in there and there's no way these people are moving with me. But I guarantee you, if they don't move, I'm gonna move. And I'll touch God, and I think that's the secret. I touch God, and all of a sudden they go, whoa, he just touched God, and I wanna touch God. And then they finally go, okay, I'm coming in with you. That's how it has to be. It's not arrogance. It's a holy boldness. It's a, I'm going to touch God whether you do or not.
You cannot look at the exterior of a person. You must look at the interior of a person and see, is Jesus on the inside of them? But before you do that, you better evaluate the Jesus on the inside of you.
Roy explains how his first experience with worship music changed his life forever.
Here I am, 11 years old. I'm with my mom. My mom's going to this Bible study church thing, and I really wasn't engaging in anything they were doing. It was kind of boring to me and stuff. But when I heard that music, maybe the first time in my life I felt peace. And because I saw the guitarist up there playing, I just told the Lord, Lord, I want to do that the rest of my life. And I walked up to the guitar guy and I said, could I play your guitar? And it was so cool. He was like, no. I said, will you show me a chord? He showed me an E minor chord. It's like two fingers on the first fret. And I just played it for like a week. I came back the next week and I said, can I play with you guys? I learned how to play the E minor. And they're like, sure, kid, but you can't plug in our little speaker system because, you know, you're a kid. And I would like, I'd wait for the E minor chord to come and I'd go. I just led worship, you know, and I just wait again, another 2 minutes, here it comes. Ooh, I led worship again, you know.
After talking with Roy, I realized that none of the people appearing on the stage had a squeaky clean image you'd expect of a TV preacher. Even Todd Bentley did not grow up in a faith-based home.
I had a troubled childhood. I was a little hellraiser, you know. It was difficult. My mother raised me. She was deaf. She had a handicap. So, and my father was out of the picture. You know, I mean, I saw him like once a year, like, you know, the summertime. Maybe if it was a good year, maybe twice. You know, I'd see my father and we'd get drunk at 11, 12 years old. And so I grew up real quick. And then, of course, you know, I got involved in all kinds of criminal activity and ended up going to prison, 14, 15 years old. Got out of prison at 16. Ended up in different foster homes for a time period. Was a drug addict. So everything was really rushed for me, and it was very fast-paced and sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Let the anointing oil, hallelujah, the anointing oil of the Holy Ghost go to work tonight. I'm making a Holy Ghost mess. But we're saying, God, every request tonight. We love the oil. We do. We love the oil.
However, the nightly broadcasts and fame and fortune have made Todd a lightning rod of controversy.
We made a joke about Todd because on God TV, all you ever saw on their website was Todd, 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 Todd. So we started calling it Todd TV. So we started singing these songs like, you are the Todd that healeth thee. I am a friend of Todd.
Todd touch me.
You are Todd. You are. Have you talked to Todd? Hi.
Off camera.
Hang on a second. You can't be here for this one.
Todd's decision to tour the world and close the tent down is a surprise to those who have helped him start the outpouring.
Without any warning at all, Todd walked into my office, and in about a 3-minute conversation, he just said, I'm handing you the baton tonight. You're taking over. It was a little bit of a shock, so to speak, but at the other hand, I've been walking in my destiny. Nothing has surprised me at this point in a way that I've said, oh my God, I never expected that. You know, it's just been, okay, all right, this makes sense now.
Brent Rousseau is a wandering missionary and has traveled all the way to Lakeland to protest the excesses of revival.
I was ordained at 20. I went through Bible college right out of high school. So excited about going into the ministry, so excited about seeing God move and having revivals and all these things that we pray for. And no one wanted to give me any type of voice. So I kind of gave up on church. As soon as I read that every disciple sold everything, gave everything away, had complete freedom and having nothing apart from the Spirit of God, I decided, man, I want that. So I just sold everything I had, quit my two jobs, gave all my money away, and lived on the streets as a homeless man for a year, just to kind of have a bird's eye view on the poverty stricken and the wealthy overchurched. And it just, I haven't been able to go back to the normal way of doing life since then. I know that there's plenty of Christian TV stations that broadcast worldwide, and I have plenty of amazing friends in Uganda, and there's a sad thing going on there. There's pastors there that mimic the American church and what they see on the Christian TV station, and they see the flash and they mimic the flash, and a lot of times when you try to mimic that bang, you know, you get burnt, you hurt yourself.
Just 90 days ago, Todd Bentley arrived in Lakeland, an unknown preacher, the least likely evangelist to be thrown into the limelight. From a few meetings in a small church, Todd has given birth to a movement that is shaking Christianity. But will the tour that he is launching now shake the world?